ordinal functions, because those are magical numbers and they're going to come up for us later when we do the trace formula. So the first special value was, of course, this great discovery that Euler made, that it's eta of 2, which is 1 plus a 4th plus a 9th plus etc. was equal to pi squared over 6. And that was made a big splash at the time when he discovered it. He was still in his 20s, and then he checked that it's eta of 4 was pi to the 4th over 90. And then eventually to prove that zeta of 2n was of the form pi to the 2n times the rational number. They couldn't do the odd powers of zeta. He worked quite hard on that. He did a lot of computation on it too, but could never identify the special value. Now, Euler did this in his first efforts, and then he did another very great paper where he investigated the values of the negative integers and discovered the functional equation. So remember, the functional equation is this pi to the minus s over 2, gamma of s over 2, zeta of s. This is the factor that at infinity for the real place. Remember, this is the Artinel function for k equal q, and the representation being the trivial representation of the, there is no downward group. And then that's the same as when you replace s by 1 minus s, so that becomes pi to the s minus 1 over 2, gamma of 1 minus s over 2, zeta of 1 minus s. So if you have something about the values at 2, you get something about the values at minus 1. And if you have something about the values at 4, you get something at the values at minus 3. So those turn out to be nicer. They're actually rational numbers. So zeta minus 1 turns out to be minus a 12th, and zeta of minus 3 turns out to be 1 over 240, and zeta of minus 5 turns out to be minus 1 over 252. I'm nervous that this might be 120, but all right, we'll worry about that. And in case you think they are always 1 over something, when you get down to zeta of minus 11, you start getting numerators, and that's the famous 691, the first 327.60. And these are all rational numbers that correspond to the very closely to the rational numbers that appear in this even power of pi as you apply the functional equation. I'll show you later how Euler was able to come up with these amazing formulas and discover the functional equation. Now, the denominators of these numbers are pretty much in control. So for example, a number like this, which looks kind of frightening, actually factors as 2 cubed times 3 squared times 5 times 7 times 13. And we know what are in the denominators of these numbers, but the numerators are extremely mysterious. So, and they get quite large. Because if you do the functional equation, you realize that if d is even, and d is very much bigger than 0, then zeta of d is essentially equal to 1, right? Because it's equal to 1 plus 1 over 2 to the d plus 1 over 3 to the d, etc. These are incredibly small numbers. So for all practical purposes, it's 1. And then you can calculate what the size is of zeta of 1 minus d if you use the gamma factors and the powers of pi, etc. And if I did this correctly, you find that zeta, using this estimate for zeta of d, that the value at 1 minus d is 2 times d minus 1 factorial over 2 pi I to the d. So that gets the sign right, too. You see the signs alternate, minus, plus, minus, etc. So this is minus, plus, minus, plus. This is for even d and in the reals. So this becomes an extremely large real number, and in particular the numerators become much larger than the denominators, which we control, and the primes that appear in the numerator are just God-given constants, and they come up all over the place in mathematics. Now, Euler was also happy to prove, although he couldn't calculate zeta of 3, he could prove that for d odd, and greater or equal to 1, that zeta of 1 minus d was equal to 0. So for d even, the zeta of 1 minus d is always a rational number. And a 0 is certainly a rational number. So all the values in negative integers are rational numbers. We're going to see what the generalization of that is. If you have a rational number, as I say, you want to know what its denominator is to clear it out. And Euler proved that if you took 2 to the d times 2 to the d minus 1 times zeta of 1 minus d, that was an integer. So this is really almost best possible for clearing out the stuff prime to 2 in the denominator.
Can I do d bigger than 1?
D odd, thank you, greater than or equal to 3. Yeah, zeta of, thank you, Dorian. Zeta of 0, we're going to see, is minus a half. That's the only one that, and that has to do with the pole at s equal 1. So this is very good. And so if you look at some of these things, this 252, what is that? That's 4 times 63, right? So 63 is 3 squared times 7. So that's exactly what you get here. That would clear out the 63 perfectly. But you see, this 2 to the d is a little too large because we only need 4. But this is a crude result, and we'll see how Euler proved it. And those integers are going to come up all over the place. Let me give you some other special values that are even more interesting in some sense than these, where we have some control over the size. So remember, I told you that there's this great result that Dirichlet proved. You can he studied it at s equal 1. But at s equals 0, it says that for any number field k, that this is the leading term. It has order r1 plus r2 minus 1. And the leading term is minus the class number times the regulator over the number of roots of unity, plus, you know, s to the r1 plus r2, etc. So the order vanishing at s equals 0 is this. And the leading term is that number, where this is the determinant of a matrix of units, very complicated thing. Now, the cases where this order of vanishing is 0 are exactly when either R1 is 1 and R2 is 0, or R2 is 1 and R1 is 0. That's it. Otherwise, it vanishes. So if k is equal to q, you get R1 is equal to 1 and R2 is equal to 0. So that tells us that zeta of s is just equal to this number. Now, the class number of Q is 1. The regulator is 1 because it's a determinant of a 0 by 0 matrix. The number of roots of unity is 2, so you get minus a half, as I said over there. And if you take quadratic fields, well, you either have R1 is 0 and R2 is 1. That would be an imaginary quadratic field. That would be when D is negative. Or you have R1 is 2 and R2 is 0. That would be a real quadratic field, right? Now, in this case, the zeta function is non-zero because of this order of vanishing is 0. And here we find that zeta k of s is equal to, well, you have a class number. We'll call it h of d. The regulator is, again, 1 because there are no units of infinite order. And here you have divided by w of d, where w is usually 2, but could be 4 or 6. And in this case, you just have that zeta k of s is equal to, is equal to 0. Just like all those odd things were 0, here it just happens to vanish to order 1, so its special value is 0. Now, we saw that for quadratic fields, we could factor the zeta function as the Riemann zeta function times the Dirichlet-L function, where this was a character of the multiplicative group mod D. And so, that also tells us what the value is of this at s equals 0. We just take the ratio of the value. So we find that L chi d at 0, and this is another special value. This is an Artin-L function of a non-trivial representation. The dimension of V is 1, and the Galois group is the Galois group of K over Q. So you have the quadratic character of that group. And you find that it's equal to, well, in the imaginary quadratic case, you have to take this number and divide it by that number. So it's 2hd over wd, which is usually equal to the class number of the imaginary quadratic field once the number of roots of unity is 2. And in the real quadratic case, its value is 0 because this thing vanishes to order 1 and this thing vanishes to order 0. Okay. Now, whenever you see class numbers come up in a counting formula, like when it comes up in the classical trace formula, you should think, well, those are really just values of this L function at 0. But I should say that we know much less about those values. For example, what the size of the class number is for imaginary quadratic fields is a famous question that goes back to to Gauss. So we believe, the conjecture would be, that this class number of an imaginary quadratic field, which we know is bounded by a constant, I think you can take 2, Dorian, you tell me if I'm wrong, but I think you can take 2 times the absolute value of d times log of the absolute value of d. We know that. We suspect that it's greater than some constant, sorry, d to the 1 half, that would have been wrong. D to the 1 half over log d. It would have been correct, but it would have been stupid. So we think it's about the order of the square root of the discriminant. And the error term should be a positive log d here and divided by log d here. But this would be great if anyone could do it. The problem is, you see, if you try to use the functional equation and you compare it to, so here is the value at 0, by the functional equation, that would compare it to the value of chi d at 1. The value of chi d at 1 is given by a conditionally convergent series. I mean, this is the sum of chi of n over n for n greater or equal to 1 prime to d. These coefficients are either plus or minus 1, and they alternate mod d. So this series is actually conditionally convergent, but we have no idea really how large this number is. Dirichlet proved it was non-zero, essentially by proving this formula for it. But if we could show that the value of the L series at 1 was on the order of equal to 1, if the convergent value of this conditionally convergent series was about equal to 1, then we would obtain this estimate from the functional equation. But the problem is that there might be a zero of this L function very close to S equal 1. I mean, here's the line between S equals 0 and S equal 1. And here it's non-zero, but maybe there's a zero very close to it. And that would make this value small. And that's called the Ziegle zero. And if you want to know more about it, you go to Dorian's course. But Dorian made tremendous progress on this conjecture, where he's able to show that under certain hypotheses on elliptic curves, the class number was at least bigger than a constant times the logarithm of d, which is very far away from d to the 1 half. But that was the first effective estimate on class numbers. Okay, so these are examples here and examples here of special values of L functions which turn out to be rational numbers. So what's the general theorem? And what are the denominators, etc.? So let's take the most general case. So let's start with the number field, although we're going to make a lot of remarks about the function field case because that's really a big help. So we'll take a number field. And we take a Galois extension of it like we've been doing before, and we take a representation of this Galois group, some specific representation, into the general linear group. And then we were able to make the Artinel function, and I'm going to write down the complete Artinel function, which is as a product over all places v of k, some local L function, Lv, Vs, where this is given by the determinant of Frobenius at the finite places and at the infinite places given by some gamma factors. And then the functional equation is that this is an exponential term, which I wrote Av of s, it's a constant times the conductor, et cetera, and then the same thing for the dual representation at 1 minus s. That was our functional equation. Now, what's clear from this definition, this Euler product definition, these Euler products only converge for real part of s greater than 1. But in the plane of convergence, these terms are all non-zero. Because the eigenvalues, I mean, if you take something like the determinant of 1 minus fp, norm of p to the minus s on VIP. The eigenvalues of Frobenius are roots of unity. When you take norm of p to some positive number bigger than s, that can't be zero on V. So these determinants are all non-zero. This product is of non-zero elements. The function doesn't vanish. So this is non-zero for the real part of s greater than 1. And by the functional equation, one concludes that it's also non-zero and holomorphic, etc., for the real part of S less than zero. So if you're in the complex plane, you have the points 1 and 0. For all points strictly to the right of here, it's regular and non-zero. For all points strictly to the left of here, it's regular and non-zero. The mystery is how it behaves in this strip between 0 and 1. Now, it's also known, it's not very difficult to show, that at the point S equal 1, and consequently at the point S equals 0, because this is always non-zero. This is an exponential factor. This looks like A times B to the 1 half minus S. So that's always non-zero. It's known that at the point 1 and 0, this has a pole. At S equals 0 and S equals 1 of order, the dimension of B fixed by the Galois group. Because that's what comes, remember, we could write this as this was a product over the irreducible representations, and you get this many copies of the trivial representation, and the trivial representation, the L function is the zeta function, that has a pole at S equals 1. So at these points, two points, we might have poles. Depends on whether the trivial representation occurs. But Artin conjectured, and this is the big open conjecture on Artin L functions, first, that it's regular for all other S. So no other poles in this critical region here, where you can't use the Euler product because it doesn't converge. So you have to use some other representation of the L function. And the second conjecture, which is called the generalized Riemann hypothesis, is that it vanishes only for points where the real part of S is a half. So only on this critical line is it supposed to have any zeros at all. It should have an infinite number of zeros on that critical line. And so far, I think what we know about this is very marginal. For example, one of the deep theorems, which is a generalization of the prime number theorem, is that it doesn't vanish along this line, and consequently it doesn't vanish along this line. Already, just getting to that line and proving it doesn't vanish is very difficult. So to get into the interior of the critical strip, well, that's the Riemann hypothesis. Now, they proved all these conjectures for function fields. So in the case where K, this is some Galois extension of function fields. It's all known. Well, it has to be slightly rephrased. So I'll show you what it's like for the trivial representation. Let's take B to be the trivial representation. Well, then the L function, or this lambda Bs, is what we call the zeta function. And we saw that for a curve over a finite field, so this is f of finite field with q elements, curve of genus g, that this was a polynomial of degree 2g at q to the minus s, divided by 1 minus q to the minus s, 1 minus q to the 1 minus s. So as a function at s, it was rational in q to the minus s, and the rational function had degree 2g minus 2. Now, if you think about that, it doesn't make sense to think of this as a function on the complex plane. Because if you're taking powers of q, it becomes periodic. So if you replace s by s plus 2 pi I over log q, you get the same value, right? Because of the periodicity of the exponential function on the upper half plane. So it's better to think of this as a function on the cylinder. Whoops. Where you take arbitrary real values of s, but you only say take complex values of s from 0 to 2 pi I over log q, and then you wrap that around itself and you have a function on a Riemann surface. This is introduced by Taitner's thesis. There's a certain Riemann surface of quasi-characters, and in the number field case, that Riemann surface turns out to be the entire complex plane. In the function field case, it turns out to be the quotient of the complex plane by this discrete group of translations by 2 pi I over log cube. So, see, since you have a pole in S equal 1, here's our, why do we have a pole in S equal 1? Well, because they proved Artin's conjecture that the zeros of this polynomial were on the line real S equal a half. So the zeros on, has two G zeros on line real part of S equals a half. And this clearly has a pole at S equal 1. And this contributes the pole at S equals 0. So you have simple poles at those two points, and then you have two G zeros. So if you didn't do this cylinder, you'd have a pole at 1, and then you'd have a pole here, and then you'd have a pole here, and that would be kind of stupid. So we only have one pole on this Riemann surface here. We have another pole on the Riemann surface here. And on the line between 0 and 1 and a half, there are two G zeros spaced out on this line somewhere. Well, that was Vey's proof of the Riemann hypothesis, at least for the zeta function. And then Vey understood the relationship between these L functions and the zeta function of the larger field. And using the Riemann hypothesis for this, he could prove it for all the Artin L functions. So this is just a trivial representation, but that's, the best evidence for this conjecture that we have. So here's how you don't want to prove the Riemann hypothesis. For those of you who want to prove the Riemann hypothesis, you can't do it by analysis alone. So here's an example to try to show you that you can't prove this statement just by, I have a function, it satisfies the functional equation, that kind of stuff. Because take an imaginary quadratic field, take your base field K to be imaginary quadratic, but assume that the class number is bigger than 1. And consider the zeta function of that quadratic field. I mean, that's not the complete thing. I mean, the complete thing would be 2 pi to the minus s, gamma of s. So this would be the L function of the trivial representation. So write that as 2 pi to the minus s, gamma of s. And then you have the sum. Because the zeta function is the sum over all the ideals in the ring of integers of 1 over the norm of I to the s power. This is for real part of s greater than 1. Now we divide this sum up. And by first dividing the ideals into ideal classes and then summing over all the ideals in that class. So we write this as 2 pi to the minus s, gamma of s. The sum over the class group, some finite abelian group. And then for every class in C, C in the class group, and then we just sum over the ideals such that the class of I is C of 1 over the norm of I to the S power. So we write this as a finite sum of Dirichlet series. So this would be the Dirichlet series where you had An over N to the S, where this would be the number of ideals of index n in A. And this series would be the sum of an c over n to the s, where you had the number of ideals in the class C, which had index n. And when you added all those up, you'd get an. Right? Now this series was the basic object that was considered before people even knew what a zeta function was. That was the series that was studied by Dirichlet, because if you know the relationship between ideal classes and imaginary quadratic fields and binary quadratic forms of that discriminant, if you just take the sum over I with class of I in C of 1 over norm of I to the S, then that's rather closely related to the series where you take the sum over all M and N not equal to 0, 0 of 1 over A M squared plus B M N plus C N squared to the S power, where AX squared plus BXY plus CY squared is the binary quadratic form of discriminant D that corresponds to the class I. And these were the series that Dirichlet liked to study. Because it was just an elementary definition, just like for the Riemann zeta function. So let's call this thing zeta C of S, or something like that. So the zeta function is made of summing up of each of these different zeta functions for ideal classes. Now, the way Dirichlet showed, proved the class number formulas, he showed that all of these essentially behaved in the same way. They had the same residue at s equal 1, and they all satisfy exactly the same functional equation. So functional equation, which you can get from the functional equation of all the unramified characters, because it's exactly the same. You just take 2 pi to the minus s, gamma of s, zeta c of s, is equal to the same thing at 1 minus s. 2 pi to the s minus 1, gamma of 1 minus s. Well, it's really zeta of c inverse of s, but that turns out to be the same as zeta of c of s. It turns out that the binary quadratic form associated to the class C and to the class C inverse, just you change the sign of B, but it represents the same norms, so you could have equally well put zeta C in here. So this function has exactly the same analytic properties as the original zeta function, but it's only a piece of it. And it has the functional equation, it has a pole at s equal 1, But we know that for these functions, which are sometimes called Epstein zeta functions, although as I say, they go back to Dirichlet, they do not satisfy the Riemann hypothesis. Namely, I don't know the exact theory of this. Dorian knows much better than I do.
But these things don't have Euler.
That's the point. That's what I was going to say. So these things fail to satisfy the Riemann hypothesis. What I was going to say, Dorian, is I think they even have zeros arbitrarily closed.
Nothing. The zeros are to the right.
And they even have zeros in here. And the reason they have zeros there is there's no Euler product. By breaking this L function up, this thing had an Euler product over all the primes, ideals in A. Right? But by breaking it up, these no longer have Euler products. But if you think of it, what does an Euler product mean analytically? That's a number theoretic thing. And it's very difficult. You know, every time some analyst announces that he has a proof of the Riemann hypothesis, the first thing you should look in his paper is where is he using the fact that it has an Euler product? Otherwise, he may have also proved the Riemann hypothesis in this case where it's wrong. That's why it's so tricky. That's
really, I mean, no one has ever found an example of a function that satisfies a functional equation that has a zero inside the critical sphere. The counterexample
I see, are all outside.
All to the right of one.
Okay. Well, here, as I say, you get the you get the non-vanishing here for a rather simple reason because of the Euler product. Okay, so now let's talk about the special values because so what you want to do these special values is to kill the poles. So let me just, so the first thing you want to do is you want to kill the pole at s equals 0. Remember that this lambda ds has pole at s equals 0 and 1 of order the dimension of fixed by g. So we saw that for b equals c in the function field case where we had p to g of q to the minus s over 1 minus q to the minus s. So here's a way to kill the pole at s equals 0. Namely, you choose a set of places b of k, which has the property that it's not empty. That's really all you need. But what you usually do in the number field case, when you choose a set of places of K, you put all the Archimedean places in it because they behave differently. So we'll say it's not empty and it contains the real and complex places. Well, that forces it to be not empty in the number field case, but we need it to be not empty in the function field case. And we define a modified like L function, which I'll call LS BS. Instead of taking the product over all primes, we just take the product over the primes that are not in the set S of our local L function. So this is an infinite simple, sorry, this is finite. Finite set. So we're left with an infinite number of primes. We just take the product over that. So for example, if I took S to be the simplest set infinity for k equals q, and I took the trivial representation, then ls of the trivial representation is just the zeta function.
because I've taken, I only have the product over the finite primes. I don't have the gamma factors in infinity.
Now, if you wanted to rewrite that in terms of the complete product, you could take the complete product and then multiply it by the finite product, B and S. This is a finite product, so it's a little easier to analyze its analytic properties, of the inverse. Okay. Now, the key thing is that this function here, as a function of S, has a zero of order, the dimension of V fixed by the local Galois group at S equals zero. And this thing, remember, had a pole of order, the dimension of V fixed by the entire Galois group. And the dimension of G fixed by a subgroup of the Galois group is at least as large as the dimension of V fixed by the entire group. Right? And so this zero will cancel this pole, and this product will now be, even if you had just one prime in S, that's why you take S to be not empty. And consequently, this thing has to be regular at S equals zero. Let's see the zero of this function. Okay? Well, what is that function? Well, at a finite prime, it's the determinant of 1 minus fp, norm of p to the minus s on vip. And now, there's no inverse there, because I took the inverse of the local L factor, and the local L factor had an inverse in it, right? And then at infinity, there would be something like 2 pi to the minus s, gamma of s, right? Or that would be V complex inverse. There we go, thank you. And for V real, it's got this gamma of, I won't put in the 2 pi's, it has this to the dimension of V plus, and then gamma of S plus 1 over 2 to the dimension of V minus. And again, we have to put in an inverse. Okay, well, let's check this thing about S equals 0. If I look at S equals 0 here, and I look at the subspace of V that's fixed by the entire decomposition group, see, how could I get a zero here? First of all, I need to be in the subspace fixed by the inertia group to get any factor. And then I have to have the eigenvalue of Frobenius equal to 1, because at S equals 0, this is equal to 1. So I'd be in the subspace fixed by the inertia group, and then the subspace of that, where Frobenius is equal to 1, and I'd get a zero of order, the dimension of that space, which is exactly the dimension of the fixed space under the Galois. And over the complex place, well, this is to the dimension of V. Well, there it is. You know, I mean, this thing has a pole of order 1 at S equals 0, so this has a 0 of order the dimension of V. And here, this has a pole of order 1 at S equals 0, and so this has a 0 of order the dimension of V plus at S equals 0, which is the dimension of V fixed by the local Galois group. So by leaving out a few factors in the Euler product, and using the fact that we knew the order of this pole, then we can produce rather quickly a function which is regular at zero. So like zeta is regular at zero. We can evaluate it at zero, but the lambda we couldn't evaluate even at zero. Okay, the only pole remaining is at S equal 1. What happens if we do it here? Well, we take one place. So let's take our place V of degree D. So a combination of d points on the curve over the Galois closure that's stable under the Galois group. And then what do we get? Well, we have to multiply this. LV would be this p 2g q minus s. That didn't give us any trouble. Divided by 1 minus q to the minus s. 1 minus q to the 1 minus s. And then we multiply it by this factor. Now, again, this is the trivial representation, so this is just a one-dimensional space. Frobenius acts trivially on the representation, so we get 1 minus q to the d to the minus ds. Right? And that's divisible by this. So we've just canceled the poll. Okay. So now the theorem in this case is the following.
Theorem.
And this is a major generalization of Euler's results on the rationality of a zeta function. And So it's a V in the function field case. And in the number field case, it's a combination of results of Carl Ludwig Siegel and Brouwer. It says that for all integers d greater than or equal to 1, the value ls of v at 1 minus d, so that's a complex number, are algebraic numbers, and for any automorphism of the complex numbers, I call that automorphism sigma. If you conjugate this algebraic number by sigma, you get the value of the L function of the conjugated representation by sigma. So what does this mean? This just means apply sigma to the character of the representation. You get a new representation, it's determined by its character, right? Now the character of any finite dimensional representation of a finite group takes values in a cyclotomic field because it's a sum of roots of unity, right? So this would say that there are only finitely many conjugates of this, and therefore there are only finitely many V sigma. I mean, once sigma fixes the cyclotomic field in which the character of this takes values, this is equal to V. So it would say that the values of this L function are in the same cyclotomic field and they conjugate in this fixed way. So in particular, and that's the way you should maybe remember it, if you happen to have a representation that was defined over Q or even had rational character, is defined over Q, so it's on a rational vector space. So therefore, V sigma is isomorphic to V for all sigma, right? Then, and that's the way it's usually applied, LS V 1 minus D is a rational number. Okay? Now that's completely obvious in this case, right? Because what are we doing? We're plugging in a negative number, 1 minus D, into a polynomial. This polynomial has integer coefficients. So this turns out to be an integer. This quotient is a polynomial, so you get an integer. And this, you divide by that non-zero integer, you get a rational number. Here we're using the fact that Q to the n is in Z if n is greater than or equal to zero. That's all we're using. Once you have this formula. But it's much harder in the number field case where we don't have a closed form for the L function. And I'll tell you how Siegel, because in most of this is Siegel, you use Brouwer's theorem to go from one-dimensional representations to higher dimensional. But Siegel's proof is really ingenious, and it uses modular forms. And I'll do the case that Euler studied. So how does Siegel prove, for example, that the zeta function at 1 minus d is rational for even d? For odd d, this is easy for the zeta function because you see from the functional equation that it has to be zero. But for even d, this is really deep. How do you do that? So Siegel noticed, as many people have noticed, that if you took Eisenstein series on the full modular group and you calculated their Fourier expansion, it started like this. This is the Eisenstein series of weight d, remember that's an even number, or SL2z. So you'll find a computation of this in Sayre's book, of course, in arithmetic. Then it started 1 half of zeta 1 minus d. Actually, it's better to use these constants, you know, 1 half. And in the number field case, you should divide by 1 over 2 to the number of infinite places. But we'll get there in a second. 1 half this plus, that was the constant term of the Eisenstein series. And then you had the higher Fourier coefficients, q to the n. And the coefficient here was the sum of the divisors of m, which I'll write a dividing n, of a to the d minus first power. So that's the, so sometimes that's called sigma d minus 1 of n. So that's the Fourier expansion of the Eisenstein series of weight d. Now, one thing that's completely obvious is that all of these Fourier coefficients are rational numbers, because they're just, in fact, they're integers. And what Zico realized was that the space of modular forms of weight d could be defined over the rational, so that if you had a modular form of weight, let's get this off the board, if you had a modular form of weight d, then the new modular form you could call f sigma, which is where you just conjugated the coefficients, also as weight. So just then, maybe then, let's write it this way, as weight d, where sigma is any automorphism of the complex numbers. See, once you have a basis over the, once you have a basis where have rational Fourier coefficients, this is obvious, because you write this thing as the sum of ci, fi, where these things have rational Fourier coefficients. And then this modular form is just the summation of ci to the sigma, fi. And since this is a basis and these are new complex numbers, there you are. So once you know that you have a basis of modular forms, then you can conjugate it, and you also get a modular form of weight d. Now just imagine conjugating this modular form of weight d. You don't change anything here, and then you apply conjugation to this. So if you took the difference here, let's call this Eisenstein series E. If you took E minus E sigma for some automorphism of C, that would be 1 half of zeta of 1 minus D minus its conjugate, because everything else would cancel out. Right? And that would have to be a modular form of weight D, because both of these things are modular forms of weight D. But on the other hand, it's a constant. And a constant can't be a modular form of higher weight. It doesn't transform properly. The only way it could happen is if that constant is zero. And that was Siegel's proof that this number was a rational number. He inferred it from the fact that these were all rational numbers, and this came together to be a modular form. And then he proved it for other number fields for the zeta function, or the partial zeta function, by again making Eisenstein series, or making modular forms that were traces of Eisenstein series on the Hilbert modular group, where the constant coefficients were these partial zeta functions at 1 minus d. So this is the all proofs of this have used this principle. Now notice that it doesn't, one thing that's rather shocking about it is you think, well, maybe this proves that they're integers, even though they aren't integers, right? Because all the positive coefficients are integers, but how did the constant coefficient get denominators? So proofs of integrality have to be a little more clever than that. You couldn't deduce this, you couldn't get integrality out of this, but Helene figured out eventually how to get integrality out of this too. Okay, so now I should say, just so that people don't get too excited about this, that almost all the time these values are zero. So that's not so good. Almost all are zero. We saw for the zeta function of the rational numbers, half of them were zero. Likewise, but because for parity reasons, you see, if k has a complex place, and let's assume that d is at least 2 for simplicity, because I don't want to get involved with the pole at s equal 1. If k is a complex place, all of these things are 0. Why? Because in the functional equation, you have something like 2 pi to the minus s gamma s on this side, well, times, you know, the dimension of V and all that kind of stuff, but you have that factor times this LS of VS, and that should be equal to the same thing at 1 minus S, so 2 pi to the S minus 1 gamma of 1 minus S dimension of V to LS D, 1 minus S. Now here, at D, this value is non-zero. And likewise, the gamma function is non-zero. So this side is non-zero. Holomorphic and non-zero at S equal D. Well, imagine, so therefore, this side has to be negative, but look what happens. The gamma function is now being evaluated at a negative number. And there it has a pole. At every negative integer, gamma has a simple pole. So this function has to vanish there if this product is going to be regular and non-zero. So this has a pole at S equal D. So this thing has to have a zero. So for any complex place, now what happens if you have a real place? Well, at a real place, the gamma factor is a little bit more complicated. And you have something like pi to the minus s over 2, gamma of s over 2, to the dimension of v plus, and then pi to the minus s plus 1 over 2, gamma of s plus 1 over 2, the dimension of v minus. Now, if both of these things, if v plus and v minus are both of positive dimension, then the function at 1 minus d has a pole. Because either this is an integer or this is an integer, no matter what d is. If d is even, this is an, you know, if d is even, the 1 minus this turns out to be an integer. If d is odd, the 1 minus this turns out to be an integer. So the only way you could have non-zero values is if at every real place, the thing is either totally fixed by complex conjugation or totally anti-fixed. So I'll write that down. For k a number, d greater or equal to 2, assume, and that's this ls d, 1 minus d, is not 0. Then, 1, k is totally real. So you never have to worry about imaginary quadratic fields or anything like that. 2, for every real place, v is equal to v plus if v is even, and v is equal to v minus if d is odd. Namely, complex conjugation either acts all as a scalar plus 1 on v, or as all the scalar minus 1 on v, depending on the parity of d. So for the zeta functions, you get this situation, and they're non-zero for totally real fields at 1 minus even numbers. And for functions associated to odd quadratic characters, for example, associated to quadratic CM extensions of totally real fields, the zeta functions, so this would be like zeta k 1 minus d not equal to 0 for d even. And this for k totally real, and if you had a quadratic extension of k, which was what's called a CM field, where every real place became complex in this, and you took the non-trivial quadratic character, which is totally odd, you'd find that L function of chi 1 minus d is non-zero for d odd. And so they're very rarely non-zero, but when they are non-zero, they're very interesting numbers. And we're going to see this condition come up. Okay, so we got to rational numbers, but rational numbers are not good enough. You want to get to integers. And they're not integers. So how do we do that? We do that by killing the pole at s equal 1. Remember, we killed the pole at s equals 0. So to get to integers, kill the pole at s equal 1. Well, we know how to do that now. We just multiply it by something that has the appropriate order, 0 at s equal 1. So we take a set P of places which is not empty and disjoint from S. And we make the modified L function, LST of VS, where we take the SL function, which remember had a pole at S equal 1. So this had a pole of order dimension of V fixed by G, and S equal 1. And we multiply, this, of course, finite set. And we multiply it by the following product. We take the primes in T, and we take what looks like the Euler product, 1 minus FP norm P on VIP. But instead of putting minus S, we put 1 minus S. So to make the L factor at S, remember, we multiply by exactly the Euler factor. But instead of putting to the minus S, we put 1 minus S here. So we multiply Frobenius by the norm of P. And if you think about it, these are all finite primes, right? Because our set S contained all the Archimedean primes. So if you take a remaining set that's disjoint from S, these are all finite primes. And what's the order of vanishing of this at S equal 1? Well, this has a 0 of order, the dimension of V fixed by GP at S equal 1, because I'd have to be on a subspace fixed by IP, and then I'd want Frobenius to be 1 on that subspace, and the dimension of that subspace tells me how many times I have 1 minus norm of P to the 1 minus S, and each one of those vanishes to order 1 at S equal 1. Right? So this function now is regular at both S equals 0 and 1, and if you believe Martin's conjecture, it'll be regular everywhere. All right, let's see two examples of this, and now I can show you Euler's amazing proof of the rationality, because Euler was on to this ST modification before we had it. So let's take the case where K is Q, V is the trivial representation, and S, which has to contain the Archimedean primes, is as small as possible, right? And T, which has to be disjoint from S and non-empty, is as small as possible, so let's just put the prime 2 in. Okay? So what do we get for LST of VS? Well, LS was just the zeta function of K. It is the Riemann zeta function, because all we left out was the factor at infinity, which is what they left out to begin with. And then we have to multiply it by this factor at 2, and Frobenius acts trivially, so this would just be 1 minus 2 to the 1 minus s power. Okay? Let's see what that looks like. The zeta function is 1 plus 1 over 2 to the s plus 1 over 3 to the s plus etc. And we have that minus 2 times 2 to the minus s times this. Right? So that would be 2 times 1 over 2 to the s plus 1 over 4 to the s plus 1 over 6 to the s plus, right? Good? And now let's put this together, and we get 1 minus 1 over 2 to the s plus 1 over 3 to the s minus 1 over 4 to the s plus 1 over 5 to the s minus, etc. Which Euler much preferred to work with. Let's call that zeta star of s. Okay? So Euler realized that this function was much more pleasant to work with analytically than the original zeta function. Because, for example, we certainly killed the pole at s equal 1, but we can evaluate it at s equal 1. Zeta star 1 is the conditionally convergent series, 1 minus a half plus a third minus a fourth, right? That's what we teach our students is the log of 2. By the way, that's what proves that the zeta function has a pole at s equal 1 with residue 1. Right, because this function has a 0 at s equal 1 with derivative log 2. So if the value of the product is log 2, this had to have a pole of residue 1. Okay? But he also proved, his nice theorem, is that zeta star of 1 minus d is in z 1 half. Namely, the only denominators were powers of 2. And in fact, he could prove that if you multiplied it by 2 to the d, it was an integer. And you see, that's essentially what I was saying, because if you took this at 1 minus d, you'd get 1 minus 2 to the d times zeta. So, right, this is 1 minus 2 to the d times zeta of d. So you just have to figure out what the denominator. But this is already pretty astounding. Okay, now I'm going to do this. I did this at the colloquium at Columbia, so if you've all seen this, never mind. But Euler's proof was just wonderful because he didn't have analytic continuation. So we had to have some idea of how to evaluate a function like this at negative numbers. So he said, well, look, let's start with zeta star at 0. So that looks very strange. That looks like 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1 plus 1, etc. I mean, if I just formally put it in, which I can't do, it doesn't converge. Right? It looks kind of like a half. I mean, from the teaching course of probability theory, we'd say it was a half. But Euler makes a big point that, you know, you can't say this sum converges in his paper. He just explains that. And if we got worse, we do zeta star at 1, at minus 1, sorry, and that would be 1 minus 2 plus 3 minus 4 plus 5, etc. Right? So that's hopeless. So he does it in the following way. He says, well, look, you could say that this was equal to the value of the power series, 1 minus x plus x squared minus x cubed plus blah, 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 at x equal 1, right? I mean, that would certainly be one way of doing it. And he'd say, well, this power series, on the other hand, is the power series for the rational function 1 over 1 plus x, and that I can evaluate at x equal 1, right? So this only makes sense for x less than 1, but if I write it this way, I better not touch x equal minus 1, but I can evaluate it at x equal 1. And then it gets the value of a half, and that's the correct value. And then he said, well, what about this? Well, he said, well, look, if you were to multiply this series by x and differentiate it, so x times 1 minus x plus x squared minus x cubed, etc., you'd get x minus x squared plus x cubed minus x to the fourth, etc. And then if you differentiate it, e by dx, you'd get 1 minus 2x plus 3x squared minus 4x to the fourth, x cubed, etc. And then if you evaluated that at x equal 1, you'd get zeta star minus 1. He said, well, you can't evaluate that at x equal 1, but what you could do is take this function, multiply it by x, differentiate it, and Euler was good at that. He got 1 over 1 plus x squared, and I hope I did that correctly. And then he said, well, this makes sense for all x less than 1, and namely it's represented by this rational function. So at x equal 1, I'll take the value of this rational function, and he got a fourth. And from those, you see, you can then go back and get the value at zeta, because this term is non-zero, so you just divide by it, and that gives you the minus a 12th and the minus a half, etc. And he did this for all negative integers, and he found that, for example, when you got down to zeta star at minus 2, you got 0. When you multiply by x, you differentiate, and you always get the right series. And you can also see that the only denominators are powers of 2. You know, in general, you get a polynomial. You get a p of x over, 1 plus x to, the, I don't know, d plus 1 or something, whatever the hell it is, d or d plus 1. And when you set in, so this takes integer values, and this is your 2 to the d. And that was his interpretation. And then from that, he was able to discover the functional equation, so you can't really criticize it. Okay, so the general result that generalizes Euler's is the following. Theorem. So in the function field case, it's again due to A. And it's very simple. It says that LST B, 1 minus D, is an integer. So all D greater than equal to 1. That was nice, huh? Let's see what happened for the zeta function, why this worked. For the zeta function, we originally had P, 2G of Q to the minus S over 1 minus Q to the minus S, 1 minus Q to the 1 minus S. When we put in the S factor, we saw we got 1 minus Q to the minus DS, where degree of place in S is D, D is equal to S. If we take the T to also be one place, W, and the degree of W is D prime, then we get a 1 minus Q to the minus D prime to the D prime times 1 minus S. Maybe I'll write it like that. Okay, this is divisible by this. this is divisible by this. So what we're left with is a polynomial of degree 2g plus 2g minus 2 plus d prime in q to the minus s, where this thing has integer coefficients. So if I substitute in a negative value of s, is an integer power of q, I clearly get an integer. And in general, a good way to think of this, for those of you who know anything about algebraic curves, and Bay certainly knew this about algebraic curves, he got this, this is the one thing he liked in Chevalier's book on the subject, is this is supposed to be, this original zeta function is the determinant of a Frobenius operator on, you know, h1 of the curve, and these two factors are on h0 of the curve, and this is on h2 of the curve. And so you have cohomology in